Sustainability Authority for their special address. Over to you, sir.
Good morning to all of you. Mr. Rajendra Mirghane, Joint Chairman, Maharashtra Housing Development Corporation. Mr. Anthony Disa, Chairman, Madhya Pradesh RERA and former Chief Secretary, Madhya Pradesh. My colleague in Government of Maharashtra, Shri Deepak Kapoor, Chief Executive Officer of SRA. Shri Milind Meister, Vice President and CEO, MADA. Mr. P.K. Gupta, Managing Director, SBI. Consul General of China in Mumbai. Consul General of Israel in Mumbai. Dr. Ravi Gupta, RERA Chairman Mr. Kumar Swami from Goa, Commissioner Housing, Chhattisgarh, Mr. Singh, NAREDCO Secretary Mr. Rajan Madhirkar, CREDAI officials, friends and delegates. You must be wondering that for affordable housing summit, the organizers have given a lot of time for water regulator also to speak to you. When we talk of housing, without realizing, we are talking of too many things. It's not just brick mortar house. It includes many things such as electricity, it includes water, it includes finance, and many other things. When we talk of water, we are actually talking about drinking water, we are talking about drainage system, we are talking about sewage treatment plants, we are talking about reuse of water. So there are so many things in just one word, housing. And when we talk of affordable housing, actually, we are talking of affordable electricity, we are talking of affordable water, we are talking of affordable disposal systems. Everywhere in the country now, there is a regulator in electricity sector. Everywhere in the country now, we have a regulator in the housing sector, that is real estate, RERA. But all the states do not have water regulators. Maharashtra is one of the few states which conceptualized a water regulator, because we faced the problem in 2003 and we found that water is going to be the key economic driver for the state of Maharashtra. Maharashtra contributes 15% to the national GDP. It is one out of the 28 states. 28 because J&K is no longer a state. It is out of the 28 states. It has 9% of India's population, but it contributes 15% to the national GDP. And if you break it down, then 1.5% of the national GDP comes from Maharashtra water. So it is that important. Maharashtra realized that unless we have a regulator in the water sector as well, we are going to have a very chaotic situation. So in 2005, Government of Maharashtra proposed an act and Assembly passed it immediately. See, making a regulator means giving away some of your powers and asking a third person, third agency to regulate it. But in water also, Government of Maharashtra and the entire Maharashtra legislature passed this act and said, let us have a regulator in water sector. Means I am giving away my powers, let the third person look into it. So that was a great step in 2005, and 2006 the first regulator came in. Now in the country you have only three places where regulators are in place, water regulators are in place. One is Maharashtra, one is UP, and the other is J&K. But I will say that UP is yet not established because they just have a chairman, they don't have members. They are yet to be appointed. Never the members were appointed. J&K is a very small regulator dealing only with drinking water. They don't deal with other things. But Maharashtra, water regulator, which consists of a chairman and four members. These four members are experts. They are experts from underground water system. They are experts from surface water engineering, legal, as well as water economics. So this authority of five, we work with three very important sectors. One is agriculture, where 75% of the resources, water resources, are allocated to agriculture. Second is domestic, where 15% of entire resources are allocated to domestic. And third is industry, 10%. So 75, 15 and 10 is the broad allocation to different sectors. Water resources of Maharashtra will include two very important sources. One is the precipitation, natural, and the second is the underground water. Natural precipitation is flowing through various rivers, either eastwards or westwards. Government of India, way back in 1976, decided to have tribunals for different rivers because rivers cross through one state and then second state and then finally into the Bay of Bengal or in the Arabian Sea. So therefore, the government of India said all rivers must have a tribunal, and tribunal will decide how much of precipitated water you can retain in the state. Therefore, all the four rivers which are passing through Maharashtra, Narmada West, Tapi West, Krishna East, Godavari East, all these four rivers have certain allocation given to Maharashtra as per the tribunals. That is the only source, that is the only quantity of water I have in the state. Then I have the underground water. Underground water is actually traversing through many states in the aquifers, but we don't know that. Unless we do the mapping, we don't know how it is traversing. Therefore, everybody feels that underground water is mine. In my field, my bore well, my well, it is mine. It is not so. It is not the property of an individual because it is traversing through various places. So our sources are very limited, precipitated water and underground water. In that, I told you that we have three allocations, agriculture, industry and domestic. Now come to domestic, which is the subject for today. Our job is to decide the quantity that each person will get. Our job is to decide the tariff for agriculture, for domestic, as well as for industry. In industry, different types of industries will get different type of allocations. Power industry will get something, paper industry will get something else. In domestic, we have urban and rural. In urban, we have different categories. A, B, C municipalities will get only 100 liters per day per person. In municipal corporations, they will get 135 liters per capita per day. And in Mumbai, we have given 150. Now, as compared to 150, 135 and 100, if you see the figures, you will be really surprised to see that Mumbai is using 250 per capita per day as against an allocation of 150. So that is where the issues of affordability come. When we talk of affordable housing, we are actually talking about whether water is affordable or not, whether the sanitation system is good or not, whether the sewage treatment is good or not. In Mumbai, the total generation of sewage is 2,271 MLD. Out of that, Mumbai is only able to treat 67% because they don't have capacity. So 37% of untreated waste, liquid waste, is going into rivers and the sea. That is why you see that sea is so dirty and the banks of the coast of Mumbai is so dirty, and river like Miti and all, they're so dirty. So 33% of the capacity has to be established. It has to be made and then it has to be used properly. If you don't use it properly, then sewage treatment is not going to be 100%. My request to the friends from the building industry is that, of course, it is your job to make a drainage system which is proper. In large complexes, you must also, and you are doing it, you must also make a proper sewage treatment plant. just making the sewage treatment plant for the purpose of getting OC is not correct. Then you are actually fooling the public. Getting OC is one step, but whether that housing complex, whether that society, are they trained to run the sewage treatment plant or not? Because municipal corporations also find it difficult to run these STPs because of lack of training, lack of finance, and most important, lack of priority. I keep saying that the priority of a municipal commissioner changes every day. In Maharashtra, the municipal corporations are very, very vibrant. But the priority changes every day, as per the people's demand, as per the demands of the public representatives. If you put a pressure of High Court and Supreme Court and maybe the Chief Secretary or CM, the pressure will go up on the Commissioner, and Commissioner will bring the matter of STP treatment or sewage treatment on top. But it will not remain on top forever. The moment the pressure is reduced, it will slide down to the lowermost bracket. So priority is a great issue. Priority in terms of sewage treatment and managing the liquid waste is a great issue, and it succeeds only there where the individual commissioner or individual officer is very much interested. Then it succeeds. Otherwise, if the officer is changed, the priority also goes down. So the biggest issue in India is our priority in sewage treatment. And why is it so? Because first of all, it is not viable. Secondly, it's not a glamorous job. What is glamorous? Making a road, new carpeting a road, airports, school buildings, hospitals. I will go to the extent of saying that even statues. They're very, very glamorous jobs. You get a lot of claps. But making a sewage treatment plant which is far away from the city, nobody is going to see that. The drain is underground system, which is nobody is going to see that and clap. Therefore, it doesn't get the priority. So the point that I want to drive today is, please give it a priority, otherwise all this affordable housing that you are thinking of is only a very, very temporary measure. You will hand over the key to the person, but after 10 years or 5 years, that person will feel very, very cheated because the entire system has not been addressed. So brick mortar houses, electricity, water when I say, it's all 3-4 things combined together. That is why this affordable housing summit becomes very important, because I must thank Dr. Ravi Gupta that he thought of water for the first time in housing, and he gave time that water is a very important subject, we can't leave that behind. We are also talking about Har Ghar Nal Se Jal. This is the latest from Government of India, Har Ghar Nal Se Jal up to 2024. But we have forgotten that once we give the water to everybody in the village by pipeline, have you also thought of the drainage system? Have you also thought of the sewage treatment? Sewage treatment in the cities is very difficult. Forget about the sewage treatment in the villages. Therefore, are we thinking of technology, innovation? Are we thinking of decentralized mobile sewage treatment plants which can handle a village? These are the issues where we have to work, and we have to innovate, and we have to come out with solutions. All those industries who are present here, please take down a few things. Decentralized sewage system, sewage treatment plants in the villages, in small municipalities, in one area you have to work. Second, sewage treatment plant in cities with modern technology, less cost. And last but not the least is reuse and recycling of the water, that is treated water. I'll give you figures. Israel, generally sitting here, Israel is treating 90% of the sewage water collected. And out of that, 86% they are reusing. Topmost figure in the world. Singapore is treating 100%, however, they are using only 35%. So in case of reuse, Singapore is far, far behind Israel. And in case of treatment of 100% collected sewage, Singapore is on top, but Israel is on top in case of reuse. 65% of the agricultural requirement of Israel comes from treated water. Now come to city. I just want to request you all, because NAREDCO chief is here, secretary is here, I would like to request you that now it is the right time to think of two parallel lines. One for the fresh water that is used only for hygiene, drinking, cooking, etc. and the other which can be used for other purposes. If you have that system, then all the water which is treated by the municipalities and municipal corporation, they will have a proper consumption center also. This is one area. Second area is that just like Israel, we are also thinking of, now this is for you, the industry people, as a regulator, now this time when I'm fixing the tariff for 2022 to 2023, the next block of 3 years, which is the control period, I am going to say that for every STP in the city, a radius of about 10 kilometers will be earmarked for use only of treated water by the agriculturists. If they take fresh water, then the fresh water cost will go by 10 times. You get my point? If STP is there and you are in a radius of 10 kilometers of the STP, all the gram panchayats falling in that area will have to take only the treated water for agricultural purposes. One caution, when I say agricultural purpose, the band of purity of water has to be decided. What crop and whether it is going to affect the human lives or not, all those things will be decided. But it is a must for you to take only treated water. Otherwise, you will have to pay 10 times the cost of fresh water which you are taking from the dam. Right? This is one measure that the regulator is going to take now. And we will also be making sure that the economic cost of water, development cost of water, and the actual cost that you are paying is displayed to public. When I said Maharashtra is contributing 15% of GDP, of national GDP, I mean that economy of Maharashtra is much more vibrant than the others. Therefore, water has a higher economic cost in Maharashtra than in places like, let's say, Odisha. It has a high economic cost. Production cost may be perhaps the same in both the places, but the economic cost is much higher in Maharashtra. So can we at least go up to the production cost? If the production cost is 100 rupees, you are paying only 10 rupees, can I tell the public that be prepared? Tomorrow you have to go from 10 to 15, 15 to 20, 30. If not this regulator, some other regulator. But he will force you to go because he will not be able to give you water. Right? So these are the only few points I wanted to mention here and sensitize that you cannot leave water as a separate issue. When you are talking about water supply, you have to take water into account, you have to take the purity of water, you have to take the amount of water that is to be used, and you also have to take the cost of water that is to be paid. So that is where the regulator comes in. If you have any suggestions, I will be leaving my contact details with Dr. Ravi Gupta. You can always reach out to us and we will be very happy to help you. Thank you so much.